Bull 1, this is a short station, ground 6-8 to get on the ground.
Getting ready for his last air show appearance in the white overalls in the Arrow Active.
There! Don't climb on the wall. He's climbing and I can't see. There's so many ones.
And they went for economy, and lightness, and general cheapness.
Another one.
Of purchase. That's the schedule of the 851 going on. That's the X followed by the 60G, yes. We put a dual edition Renault in instead, which put the price up and the weight a bit. It never actually sold. But from that, he went on with the advent of the Cirrus, the place of the Gypsy engine. Brilliant product of a man called Holford, Ben Holford. He produced the various models which succeeded it. Anywhere but the Shuttleworth, I'd say that was a very hairy formation. That's an extremely well-held, close formation. I think the chap on the top right's got one leg longer than the other. Or only one shoe on, yes, then. Well, what, we've got one here. And he actually won an Air Ministry contract for it. Only got a handful. But when he turned to producing proper light aircraft, up came the Mark, the original DH-60. With the ADC Cirrus, the Cirrus, the Hermes, and the Hermes, the Hermes, the Hermes, the Hermes, the majority of light aircraft in the war. And its final glory, of course, was in the jumper. That turn. 660X part, which was the last of the civilian parts, virtually, was the first to have the split axle undercarriage, as you're going through there now, number two. No longer had a straightforward axle, which cost. Whiskey Delta, the shuttle was 60X, was in 1928.
Banking.
My Richard Cutter was a problem in 1932. This is a terrible thing. And it is still in his collection. And it was re-engined from the Cirrus to the Hermes in 1933. And it had various owners. Well, Richard Cutter, the stage actor learned to fly on this particular aeroplane. Douglas and Peter Hull, well known in the aviation and motor racing world, owned it for many years. And after Douglas' death, his widow presented it to the collection. The Cirrus engine, the Hermes engine, was a very neat way of obtaining a cheap power plant, because there were enormous numbers of V8 Renault engines, which had been used in various procedures in the First World War, lying around in crisis and storm. And what often did was take one of the two bombs of Cruiser, that was also little of a Renault, design and build a new crankcase, and there was a nice little war cylinder by the aircraft engine. And when supplies of Renault bombs ran out, he later, trainer for the Commonwealth Army. after the war was refitted with a regular vehicle on the railroad. And by the end of the 20s, it was getting a bit more than two. And the replacement was asked for. Not surprisingly, perhaps, an opportunity went wrong. And also,
the start of the German time.
five others of theirs. The only Air 181 in the world. Still delivered to a Now that's a little signal. In what he saw. And there for one blissful moment were the first and last CAM designs in formation flying over the English countryside. Now you look at the layout of the wings and the tail end. Imagine that with a thin and over rudder. And you've got the heart behind. After the competition, the first aircraft was disposed of to the RAE Aero Club. The second one remains with Hawkers and is alive and well to this day. If you were to fly along with the heart and the top tip, and then there were nukes to fly in the cap on back of run. Which it flied very successfully at the first British success. And as aircraft was sent off singly or in pairs from squadron. Now this is a very representative bunch of aircraft in the sky. Or we'll shortly see in the air this afternoon. And bear in mind that these will be real life size. From the height and speed at which these aeroplanes were moving, the fact that the German army was about six times as strong in machine guns as ours were. You can imagine the kind of casualties that the pilots were to stop with.
Sheds and cooks up, they're
Rolls-Royce Falcon. First of the two-seater fighters. A very successful aeroplane. Once the crews had learned that you could handle it like a single-seater, the gunner was there to keep the opposition off your back. It clocked up an engine commanded by a redoubtable Canadian called Ray Collishaw, one of the most famous of the naval triplane squadrons. They clocked up a tremendous score. They also suffered extremely heavy casualties during the 35-year.
Absurdly short space of time.
the engine to keep control.
Starting this one on the left. Yeah, for road test.
The biography you want to do, sir. The difference between the autogyro and rotor blades spin freely, they're not connected to the engine. And they spin in the movement, in the slipstream, and eventually they rotate faster to a degree in an autogyro, but you still rely on forward speed from your propeller and engine to come down to land. Sheer magic. Celtic Weeks hasn't actually got his back in the air again. I don't know whether he has. He's flying the world. They saw the requirement for a very fast bomber. What was the non-strategic material?
Thank you.
successful attempt to keep the biplane owners who like the biplane happy, but at the same time give them side-by-side cabin comfort, which people were beginning to demand. Once they're beginning to dress up so they can get into it, right? So on, was impressed. And he had an unusually interesting career that he they were very weak in that time. It had not been better aircraft for the job. They were, which was in the panic days of 1940 when the expect bigger and heavier and more solid than the Geiger model. This was the successor to the Avro trainer, which was a Monkwood engine version, selected to replace the 504M.
Trying to tell them, isn't it? What's happening?
We have had bungee launches for this, but it's not been launched by bungee today, I don't think. It is. Ah. Oh, well, that's it. That accounts for it. I didn't realise you'd be using bungee.
There it goes.
And there she goes.
Go on, get it up. Yeah, but get it right up. There you are.
You see the crew over there, that counts for the Autobots.
Go on,
keep I should have guessed, shouldn't I? And he's airborne. He's distinctly airborne.
Go on, keep
it. You don't stop Suze. There's no way under heaven that she's going to be able to turn that thing. Ratio as the Formula One Grand Prix car.
been born. She passed her MOT. And here she is. She's the only air worthy Spitfire still, I believe, with the original three-bladed air screw and the original proper ejector exhaust of the early pack.
Sorry, in March 1936. Signed, of course, by R.J. Mitchell of Supermarines. Sadly died in very early middle age, I think, of consumption. But lived long enough to see his prototype fly. Clipwing Spitfire is a nice, crisp, and more complex piece of machinery, being the first semi-monocoque all-metal aircraft to be built for the Royal Air Force. The Harlequin was the traditional World War I interwar years steel tube structure with fabric just over the start of the war. They were being delivered. First of Zura, 19th Squadron at Duxford. 1939, they started to get to the auxiliary squadrons. August 1940, joined the 17th KG-2. Beginning of the war, there were 19...
Monoplane.